So I'm very happy to introduce Stefan Kemp, who's come all the way from Amsterdam and has really for decades been a pioneer in helping not just working on the molecular biology of ALD, but also setting up a database for ALD that has served the community at large. So Stefan, thanks so much for being here and also being part of ALD Connect.
So today I will talk to you about the ALD database and its renovation after 18 years that it went through earlier this year. And also about another subject, the need for translational metabolism in newborn screening. So just a brief introduction about ALD. You've heard about it from Florian earlier, but it's essential to recognize that ALD is actually three different main categories. You have all the subtypes, but in general, male patients have a high risk of developing adrenal insufficiency. They have at risk to develop myelopathy. And together, these two are named adrenal myeloneuropathy, or AMN. And patients are at high risk to develop cerebral ALD. All male patients are born with an ABCD1 mutation. And there is some time before they develop phenotypes. And these bars, these colored bars, indicate the age at which patients are at risk to develop any of these three phenotypes. So the earliest boy that was ever reported with adrenal insufficiency was 6 months of age. But there are also males that develop it in their 40s or 50s. And there are still males that are even older that have not developed it yet. So this is an age bar, a risk age bar. Myelopathy starts in adults after the age of 20. And this, together adrenal insufficiency and myelopathy, can be seen as the default mode of the disease. So a mutation in ABCD1, with its biochemical abnormalities, the variant chain of the acids, eventually results in almost all cases in adrenal insufficiency and myelopathy. Then cerebral ALD is caused by, first of all, the mutation in ABCD1, but just the mutation in ABCD1 does not necessarily lead to cerebral ALD. For that, other factors are involved and important. And these can either be genetic factors in genes that we have not identified yet, but also environmental factors. There are cases of boys that had trauma and afterwards developed cerebral ALD. So it's a combination of environmental factors and other genes. So this is really a challenge to identify these factors. But also, males that have these forms, adrenal insufficiency and myelopathy, are at risk to at any time still develop cerebral ALD. And also that we cannot predict. So a lot of challenges. But recognizing that actually this is the way the disease progresses, that is progressive neurodegenerative disorder, helps in understanding a little bit more about how we should look at this disease. So now newborn screening. On this slide, this points out to the importance of newborn screening, because both for adrenal insufficiency and for childhood cerebral ALD, so young boys, there are therapies. But the challenge is that these boys are often recognized too late. So that's the rationale for newborn screening. And it's really dramatically summarized on this slide. This is work from the Kennedy Krieger Institute. And the first one goes about adrenal insufficiency. This is a study in which 49 boys were identified in families through extended family screening. So these were not recognized earlier on as boys with ALD. And it turned out that a lot of these boys had undiagnosed impaired adrenal function. And the lessons we have learned is that adrenal insufficiency is often discovered only after several hospitalizations. So this needs to be earlier on. So the treatment can be initiated very much earlier. So that's the first rationale for newborn screening is to prevent too late diagnosis of these boys and to start treatment much earlier on. The second one is the cerebral ALD. It's another study from the Kennedy Krieger Institute in which it was demonstrated that 283 boys that were diagnosed with cerebral LD, only 19 were at the moment of diagnosis eligible for bone marrow transplant. The patients who are diagnosed on the basis of neurological symptoms are in general already too advanced for newborns for intervention. So if we would do newborn screening, we could identify these patients, these boys, at birth. I just told you that there's a window of opportunity before these boys develop the first clinical symptoms. So if we pick up these boys at birth, there is time to follow them, to monitor them. And as soon as there are signs for either adrenal insufficiency or cerebral ALD, treatment can be initiated. Of course, there's still a large population of ALD patients that develop adrenal myeloneuropathy, for which there's no therapy. And one of the other challenges that we have, so we have many challenges, is that we would like, so now we can pick up the boys, but we would like to earlier on have a way of predicting which one of these two routes an individual patient will take. So maybe then interventions can start even earlier. So newborn screening is done in blood spots from a newborn. And it involves the measurement of C26 lysophosphatidylcholine. This is a complex lipid. This test is very sensitive. As you can see, these are the control ranges. And all ALD males are elevated in this test. It's a very quick test. So now, at this moment, 5 states in the U.S. are screening for ALD. It all started in New York State, as we've heard before, with the yes, indeed. Thanks to Elisa, and then it was followed by Connecticut, and then California started in September 2016, then Minnesota in February 2017, and Pennsylvania in 2017 April, and I heard yesterday that Washington State, yes? March 2018. So even these are only 5 states yet. It's good to recognize that these 5 states represent 24% of all live birth in the US. And in the US, each year 4 million children are born. So that means that each year 1 million newborns are screened for ALD, which is quite an impressive success already. Another thing I would like to tell you, this is almost a slide that I don't dare to show because it is a no-brainer, but it's also an eye-opener. And there's a really big difference between classical diagnosis and newborn screening. Classically, a patient with clinical symptoms visited a doctor. And then the doctor looked at the patient, and if the patient showed signs of ALD, the doctor could request tests, laboratory tests, which could confirm ALD. So if there was a mutation in the ABCD1 gene, if there are elevated levels of viral chain fatty acids, or if there's a reduced capacity to break down these fatty acids in cells, this confirms the diagnosis of ALD. Now, in newborn screening, a very different setting. So a baby is born without any complaints pointing towards ALD. But it's born in a place in this planet where, in the newborn screening program, people look for elevated levels of C26 lyso-PC. So there's a biomarker. But there are no clinical clues. And it's very different than the previous. And this C26 lyso-PC is not specific for ALD. It can also it also points to Zellweger syndrome and two enzymes that are playing a role in the breakdown of these fatty acids. An entirely different disease in which the whole gene is deficient, and also there are new diseases identified that have the same biochemical signature, as I will show you in the next slide. So newborn screening is really different than classical diagnosis. And that causes diagnostic dilemmas in newborn screening. So this is the general algorithm that newborn screening labs use. So here we start with the newborn blood spot. And then in two different 10MOS spectrometry analyses with different sensitivity called tier 1 and tier 2, the C26 lysopathy is measured. So this is really a quick screen. It's not really sensitive, but it's sensitive enough to take away about 90%, 80% of the cases. So to reduce the workload in this more sensitive, more time-consuming second tier analysis. So if tier 1 and tier 2 are positive, then in tier 3, this involves DNA sequencing of the ABC CD1 gene. So in case there is a confirmed pathogenic ABCD1 mutation, it's easy. This is a newborn with ALD. However, if tier 3 has a different outcome, for example, there is no mutation identified in the ABCD1 gene, this requires further diagnostic testing. And then there's a whole lot of diseases that are also associated with C26 lysopathy. For example, the Zellweger syndrome spectrum that involves 14 different genes, ACOX1 and DBP, so that refers to enzymes of the peroxisomal beta oxidation, CDDS, ACBD5, and interestingly, a disease which you didn't know was characterized by C26 lysopathy. So earlier this year, this ACBD5 deficiency was published by our group in Amsterdam, and this is a disease that you could have predicted because this is an enzyme that captures the C26 and brings it to the peroxisome. So you can imagine if that's not functioning, you have elevated levels of variant chain fatty acids. However, Aicardi-Goudreau syndrome, it's a leukodystrophy, but we didn't know anything about its biochemistry with C26 lysopathy. It's the newborn screening in New York, and I've seen for many years, I've seen an Aicardi patient on their list, and we were always puzzled by how does it happen. And then they had a brilliant idea of reanalyzing blood spots from proven patients with Aicardi. So they put them out of the registry, and they measured them, and it turned out that 70% of these patients at birth at C26 lysopathy elevation. Why? We do not know. But this adds to the diagnostic dilemmas in newborn screening because it's just not one disease. Okay, but you can still solve that because DNA diagnosis will eventually lead to a diagnosis. But now we have another option. So what if sequencing of the ABCD1 or ALD gene results in a variant of unknown significance, which is abbreviated as a VUS or a VAUS in California. It means that there is something different in the ABCD1 gene, but we do not know what it means because it has never been reported before. Then the question is this variant pathogenic? We do not know. One of the problems is that many of these variants are not tested experimentally. In the past, we did that. We took cells from patients and we did all kinds of biochemical tests, which I will show you in a few minutes. But nowadays, this is not done anymore that often. Then we have computer programs like PolyFan2 or Shift. These are good, but they're highly insufficient. If you query these programs with all known ALD mutations, which were proven pathogenic, these programs will fail in a number of cases. So this makes the interpretation of new mutations or variants very not so straightforward. And then, of course, we have a gene which has exons, which code for the protein, but you also have introns, and they have other functions. And so if there's a variant in one of the introns, it makes it even more problematic. So clinical geneticists have come up with a classification system, 5 classes, and with descriptions. And I dare to say that only class 1 and class 5 are helpful. Because class 1 says that it's clearly not pathogenic. This is a proven harmless change in the ABCD1 gene or in any other gene. And class 5 says, okay, this is truly a proven pathogenic mutation. But there are 3 other classes. And in those cases, if you would receive a report with a class 2, 3, or 4, it doesn't help you. So in 1999, when I was a student at Hopkins, the ALD gene was identified in 1993. So then many labs and groups started sequencing ABCD1 gene in ALD patients. And this resulted in a fairly large amount of different mutations. And at one moment in the 90s, it was really cool to build a website. And at that moment, you could do it by yourself. HTML for Dummies was the first book I bought. And at one moment, I went to Professor Hugo Moser and I said, "Professor Moser, I think I have an idea. We have all these mutations that we find, and these we all publish in the literature. And wouldn't it be cool if we could make them available to anybody without having to go to the libraries?" And he says, "Stefan, that's a really good idea. I support you." And that was so great. So he supported me in that. And funny enough, I'm not sure, and if I've told you that, but we need a little bit of money for the first website. And then the John Hirschbeck Foundation, they organized a fair. And who bought the baseball bat of Cal Ripken? It was Hugo Moser. And with that money, he funded his own project. So this database has been operational since 1999, and it functions. Diagnostic labs could use it. And this is just a table that I took out of the website. Here we have a different genetic variants, and then here it says what the consequences for the protein are, and then in which part of the gene you can find these mutations, how many patients were reported with it, if it had an effect on the protein, if the protein was visible or if it was absent, and then there were references to the literature. And that was okay for, well, until last year. It was the state of California who contacted me that they run into these diagnostic problems. They identified potential babies with elevated C26, but they sequenced the gene and they identified a VUS or a FUS. And sometimes I could help them, but often we had no idea what to do. And also, the reports that I received, and I think also the other states, there was a need for more information. So then I that was in January at the newborn screening meeting. So thank you, Elisa. I decided when I was presenting there, and then during my presentation, I realized this. I said, "Oops, we have a problem." So what I did earlier this year, decided to rebuild the database. So I went back to the literature. It started in 1993 when the gene was identified, and tracked down all the publications from the literature. This is 173 publications. Over the years, I've also received from collaborating labs like the Johns Hopkins lab, our own lab, labs in Italy, their data, pathogenic mutations that were identified in patients. And I had it all stored in different Excel sheets, so I rebuilt a database. And then there's another problem, and we all these in ALD field, we talked about this type. You need historical knowledge in a research field. And this is an example. When the gene was identified, it was identified in Paris, and then in Baltimore, they started screening. They started with two different numbering systems. I will not go in too much detail, but this is ATG is where the protein starts. So one group named the A number 1, and the other group named it nucleotide number 386. This is the correct version. A is 1. But for 11 years, you find publications which use either number system. So, and this is an example. These are missense mutations. And basically, if this is amino acid 107, a codon, it contains three nucleotides. So if you want to go from the amino acid to the genetic code, you multiply this by 3, and then you're roughly in the range. So 107 times 3 is not 706. So what I had to do is go figure all data and all change it to the correct numbering system. And then I also realized that to get more power in the data is that you not say, okay, this has been identified once. No, you need to count the number of patients. So I counted all the cases for each mutation. And then when I was doing this, I got a little enthusiastic. And I said, okay, there are also a lot of research papers that do not mention patients, but they use fibroblast cell lines or any other experimental system in which the mutation is mentioned, but there's a lot of biochemical data. So these papers have additional extra data supporting pathogenicity of the particular variant. So in the end, I ended up with more than 2,500 mutations or cases, and these represented 770 different mutations. And then I decided, well, while I'm doing this, I might as well make a little report for every variant, if that's possible. And because there's no genotype-phenotype correlation, mutation does not predict the clinical outcome of a patient. So if you want to include that information, it's very, very confusing for people who do not deal with this disease every day. So I decided not to do any phenotype information. So this is what it looks now, actually until a few days ago. So now all the mutations, they are listed by their position on the X chromosome. This is an easy way to align them. And then again, we still have the mutation, we have the consequence and the exon. And then instead of saying that this has an effect on the protein, as you know, now it gives information about any mutation. So for example, this glycine 608 aspartate, it says that, it has been reported in an ALD patient. However, you also have now these databases in which people are just sequenced. And from all different studies. And all this information is put in a single database. And these databases now have more than 150,000 individuals. These are not all ALD patients. There are a few in there, I know from looking at the data. But if you find a variant that was published as an ALD pathogenic mutation, if you find it in that cohort of 150,000 people, you find it more than 300 times. This is not an ALD mutation, very unlikely an ALD mutation. So, and because everything has to be traceable, there is a link to the original paper, but there's also a link to this database showing how this variant has been reported. And then, of course, there are also true mutations. So, for example, this one, it says it has been identified in 29 patients with all the references, and it's not just a report in the patient, it also has an effect on the stability of the protein. It's reduced to only 2% in the patient cell line with a reference. So this is an experimental paper. And also other papers that have another way of looking at the protein. And you can also see that it affects stability. So this adds to the power of the quality of the information. So a little bit slides on the database, because we put a lot of effort in it, so I might as well spend some time on showing some nice data. So we're keeping track of visitors, and so this is over 10 years, more than 500,000 visitors on the website, on the rare disease. And they come from all over the world. There's only one country in the world for which we have no visitors, that's the Central African Republic. But any other country in the world, people try to find information on the website. You can see there is an interesting increase more interesting facts about this graph, because this is from 2008 to 2017, the number of visitors. And you see that consistently, in the summer, there's a lower urge for information. This is, I think, statistically significant. But there's also a rise in the visitors, and I think that has to do with newborn screening, which started here. And you see that consistently there's now a rise in the need for information. And it's not just a mutation database. I know that in 1999 it was put on the website as an ALD mutation database. But as soon as we put on the website in 1999, we started receiving emails from all over the world where people asking for information. So, and now it has much more information on ALD. For example, the fact sheets. And this is the last 4 years. So we write public scientific papers that we publish. And then we are really happy when there are, it's cited 20 times, 30 times, 40 times. But now here, the fact sheet on ALD. In the last 4 years, it's been, people have read it more than 75,000 times. And not only in English, because we also have a Spanish version. More than 70,000 times. So there really is a need for information. That's been written by, not just by me, but by colleagues, specialists on different fields of the disease. So together with Paul Watkins, we wrote a page on the biochemistry of ALD. It's both in English and Spanish. It's equal numbers, and here the mutations—it's also there. So then, when we were busy rebuilding the database, then we also decided, and that's also Elisa, because she asked me if this was a public or if this was a private database because of the .nl name. But then I explained to her, well, in 1999, I could not claim a domain name in the Netherlands because you need to have a company. So my friend claimed the domain name. And because this is confusing, we decided, okay, then maybe we should just go the full length and then make it the info database. So, and then also, because we were doing it, my friend, who's a website designer, and he has been helping me for the last 10 years with the database, his social thing, he said, well, you know what? Let's just make a new website also, because it can use a little update after all those years. So last Monday, we were ready building, and then we were sitting next to each other, because he also lives in Delft, and and we're sitting with the laptops, and then I had some questions. I want to change this a little bit and that a little bit. And then at one moment I said, okay, Ted, now what are we gonna do? He said, no, now we're gonna kill the old database. Okay. Do we really have to do that? And then what happens? So where do the people go? They said, oh, wait, they go directly to the new website. So this is the new website. It looks a little bit more up to date. And it contains all the same information. There are some issues yet, because it's not so easy to find the different languages. But we work on that. Just had to be, my deadline was this meeting. So back to what I ended several slides ago. So I was talking about diagnostic dilemmas in newborn screening. The website might help with these VUSs, these variants. It might give some clues to whether they are not yes or no pathogenic. But you remain with several cases of babies being diagnosed with elevated C26 lysis PC with a variant. And that caused a lot of stress, and we need to resolve that. The next part of the presentation, there still is a quest for translational metabolism, as we call it nowadays. So we need to know what the function of the effect of the variant is on the system itself. So for that, we still use fibroblasts. So if we would do that, we need a little biopsy from a newborn. And with that, we can do a different test, which I will show you on the next slides. So a powerful test that we have developed is that we culture these cells, skin cells, from patients in a flask, and we add to the tissue culture medium, we add a stable isotope labeled varylung chain fatty acid, deuterium labeled C22. If the ALD protein is functional, many of this, a large portion of the C26 or C22 is transported via the ALD protein into the peroxisomes and is broken down. And palmitate, or C16, is an end product that that the cell will then produce. However, if there's a true mutation in the ALD gene, this transport doesn't function anymore. So there is a reduced amount of C16 being produced. But as a consequence of not being able for this fatty acid to enter the peroxisome, it stays in the cell. But there are other enzymes that take care of this, and they elongate it, they make it longer, they make it into C26. And this ratio, C26 and C16, you can use as a diagnostic test, or the substrate and the products, different products. And so the lab in Amsterdam, the diagnostic lab in Amsterdam, I'm not the diagnostic lab in Amsterdam, I'm the research lab in Amsterdam, but my diagnostic colleagues, they have they've done this we've developed it, but they've taken over the assay, and it's really powerful. And here we see controls, and here we measure C16, so the product of peroxisomal bead oxidation, over the substrate, what you put in there. And as I showed you, if everything is functional, cells produce C16. If the ALD protein is not functional, they do produce a little bit, but it's much less. And if there are no peroxisomes at all, or no enzymes that take care of it, then you see that they don't produce anything. So there's a clear, this will help if you can do this test. And then, so that's one part, but also if they don't break it down, they elongate it. So they make C26. So now we look at C26 that's being produced. Control cells do very little with it because they break everything down. ALD cells make more C26. If this whole system is not functioning, then you see that there's even a larger buildup. So this is an additional test that you can use to get insights in yes or no, this is a pathogenic variant. And then we can also look at the protein itself. About 70% of the mutations result in an unstable protein. So either we can look at cells with immune fluorescence, so we can stain the ALD protein. These are two cells aligned, and here we see this. It's not really good visible, but here we see the nucleus, and then all these green dots are peroxisomes, which the ALD protein is sitting, and you can stain that with fluorescence. And if there's and this is a woman with a mutation, and you see that some of her cells have a normal X chromosome with a normal protein, and here's a cell that's almost dark. It has no ALD protein. So now you know this is a pathogenic mutation because it affects the stability of the protein. You can also do that. On another method. So this is an assay that was set up, and here we see different mutations and the residual amount of protein compared to controls. So normally you would expect 100%, and you see all these different mutations are truly pathogenic because they really affect the stability of the protein. But then still, you can end up with a diagnostic dilemma. And this has not really to do with the newborn screening, but this has to do with screening of women with ALD, because that's also a challenge. Because 15% of the women with ALD with a proven mutation, if you measure the fatty acids in their plasma or in their blood, it's normal. It has to do with the two X chromosomes. So my colleagues, Mark Engelen and Dr. Björn van Geel, they had two women at the outpatient clinic, and they had signs of ALD, but it could also be MS. And the diagnosis of MS is really complicated, and the diagnosis MS is not made if another disease is a possibility. And in this case, material from these women had been sent to the lab to answer the question, is this ALD? So the basic biochemistry tests were done. So the blood fatty acids and the mutation. The blood fatty acids, they were normal. Well, there's a 15% chance that we find normal fatty acids. However, when the lab sequenced the ABCD1 gene, in both women, they identified a different variant. So here at arginine, arginine 17, there was a histidine. And here at proline 58, there was a serine. And so the biochemistry didn't help us. And there was a variant in ABCD1. So the diagnosis of MS could not be made. So the challenge was, OK, help. And then normally you can look in the family if there are affected relatives. But they were not. And the question, are these variants pathogenic, was really relevant, because one of the women wanted to have a child, decided to have a child, but she said, I don't want to have a child if I have a potential lethal disease. So we were left with this challenge, and we developed a test in which we thought, okay, if we can separate these cells, because every cell in women has one of the two X chromosomes active. So either the X chromosome with the normal ABCD1 gene or the affected ABCD1 gene. But if you measure all these fibroblasts, these cells sitting together, then it's a pool of cells, and you will actually you cannot distinguish between the deficient cells. So you would like to measure it in an individual cell. And so what we did, we immortalized these cells, and now one color, the red color represents the one allele and one X chromosome, and the green the other chromosome. And then we played a single cell in a little tissue culture disc, and we let them grow. So they generate a clone. And this clone is, they are all identical cells. So we have flasks with green cells and with red cells. And then the question was, okay, are the green cells different from the red cells? So we selected three of these clones per color. Let's go. And then we did the individual tests, the biochemical tests. And as a control, we took along four cell lines from women in which we knew they had a pathogenic mutation as a proof of concept for the test. And here we see the results. So here we measure again the breakdown of fatty acids. And this is the level in controls. It's set at 100%. Male ALD cells, they are around 20%. And then here are controls for women. And if we look at the normal X chromosome, we see that the activity, the cells are normal, 100%. But if we look at the cells expressing the other ABCD1 gene, the deficient ABCD1 gene, we see that it's reduced. So these are truly pathogenic variants. And now when we looked at the effect of the mutation or variant in those women, we could see that it didn't matter which clone we measured because they were all around 100%. So the conclusion was both women had a variant that is not pathogenic. So they did not have ALD. So this is really a nice way to test this, but and we, of course we were happy, we made a nice paper, but it took us a lot of time to do this. And because it took us a lot of time, it's very expensive. And the question we had, we need to do better. So the question was, can we improve the diagnostic test in women? And can we reach a 100% or near 100% sensitivity? And for that we asked 46 women from our Dutch cohort, if they want to donate blood. And then we also had 20 female controls. And what we did, we took the blood and we separated the plasma, which is classically what you use for biochemistry analysis in blood. You take this yellow stuff. And we made blood spots. And in the blood spot, we could measure the newborn screening marker, C26 lyso-Pc. And in the blood, we would measure the classic C26. And here you see the classic analysis of C26. So the controls have a low level, all ALD males have an elevated level, and this gray area is the normal range, and you can see that around 15% of women, also in this group, 46, had normal C26 levels in plasma, but they have ALD. But this is the dilemma which you're faced if you do the classic diagnosis. So here again, so these are the 46 women, and as you can see, six of them have normal ferrone chain fatty acids, despite of being a woman with ALD. And if you do the C26 C22 ratio, which is a little bit more powerful, then still six are normal. However, if you now measure the C26 lyso-Pc in the blood spot, and all women, also these six that are in the normal range here, have elevated levels of C26 lyso-Pc. It's still, this one is still at the border, so we need to improve this test. But we went from an 85% sensitivity to a near 100% sensitivity by just measuring the newborn screening marker, which actually is also much more easier, because now you just need to make a blood spot and not draw a whole tube of blood. Where am I going now? So based on this, we say, okay, this is really nice, but can we even improve it further? And for that, we use my colleague Mark Engelen. He has set up a prospective cohort of more than 100 ALD patients that are followed up every year. So a prospective cohort to understand the natural history of the disease, all kinds of tests they do, and also every year we receive material from them. From these patients, so blood samples, the first time fibroblasts or cells, some of them, and One of the many questions we have in this cohort, can we identify these predictive biomarkers? So can we, so that we eventually early on after birth, we can predict, okay, this baby is going to develop AMN, or this baby is at high risk to develop fibro-ALD. And for this, we hope that, that these proven ALD patients can help us. But also, we do lipidomics. And I think I have just one or a few more slides. The lab has set up a lipidomics pipeline, which is very complicated pipeline, which involves a lot of analyses, but every step is fully operational at the moment. And so what we did, because we have the cohort of patients which are really well clinically followed up, so we can select subgroups. So we selected males with AMN, with the absence of cerebral ALD or no clues of cerebral ALD on MRI, and then we also have our controls. And we said, okay, if we compare these two as a starting point, if you compare these two, can we find new biomarkers? And of course, in the end, we will do many more things because we will also do the females, and we also will do patients that went from AMN to cerebral ALD because we have that material at the different stages. So patients who made the transition. So can we find biochemical clues before they develop cerebral ALD that may hint towards the development of cerebral ALD? So these are all the type of questions and studies that you can do. And this is all talking biochemistry, but you can also do it, of course, on all the other omics, genetic studies. I just want to show you one example. So this is a typical output that we generate from these studies. This is called a volcano plot. And it's a really nice way to look at an enormous amount of data, because on the x-axis, you see the control group is set at zero. And then you compare the group of ALD with the group of control. And if you find a difference, you can make a log fold of that, and then you can plot that. So this is not an individual, but this is the group. Compared to the group of controls. So on the x-axis we see a fold change, log two fold change in a biomarker. So we set this line at two, so that's four times increased over controls. And since we find a lot of biomarkers, we say okay, we can be a little more selective, so we can put our statistic line at really high significance. And if you do that, you see that, first of all, really lucky, we find C26 lysate PC, the newborn screening marker. So it would be scary if we would not find that biomarker in this test. But you can see that we find more than 30 different complex phospholipids that you can measure in plasma that are elevated in ALD. And we also find a few that are decreased in ALD. So one of the many things we need to do is, of course, validate this. So we need to take a separate group of ALD patients and do it again. And if we then get the same plot, then we have a little bit of power of the reproducibility of this data. And then what we would like to do is see, can we do any ratios? Can we, let's say, take this PC, what is it, 46.5 over LPA 22.6? And does it give much more discrimination between controls and this one woman, for example, that's sitting on the borderline, because we want to have her in a higher group. So these are the things that we are currently doing. So this is all work in progress. And that brings me to my last slide. So what we want is we want to have predictive biomarkers. So now we can pick up babies at birth, but now I think we need to set the bar a little higher, because now we want to really make a difference in predicting the outcome, so that intervention can be initiated maybe even earlier. And as I pointed out, I think, is that there still is a need for functional testing of ABCD1 variants. We need to, because families who are faced with this fuss, there's a lot of stress. And actually, there's also a lot of money involved in redoing the analyses, which will never bring an answer. So this is something that we try to tackle. And the sharing of information, I think, as I showed, is really important. So it would be great if we can set up a system in which newborn screening labs share the information with the database. Because the database is, there are more places on the internet where you can find this information, but it's not curated. And I think that's the difference. And I think this is more or less the same as the first point that I make. We need to validate what we find. And then the last slide is the ALD group in Amsterdam who is doing all the work. And thank you.
But we have a newborn screening coming up, yeah. And maybe we can have questions
yeah. Yeah, sure.
About both sessions together.